Okay, we're going to be starting chapter 8 tonight. This is an incredible chapter, and it's, you know, if you had $1,000 bill and you wanted to safe keep it, you would just stick it in chapter of the wives, and nobody would ever find it. You'd probably forget where it was too. But the chapter of the wives is very, very important. It contains material that we find nowhere else. Not only do we find nowhere else in the big book, we find nowhere else in AA literature. And we're going to see that as we go along. You know, as we've been working the big book together and reading it and considering it as we go, one of the themes which continues to pulse through all of this has to do with, I guess you would say, first step, but more really the basics. And one of the things that we always have to do when we're in recovery is to remember that we go back to basics to find answers. And the basics of our disease and the basics of our program are really pretty simple, and we need to repeat them to ourselves and keep them in mind. And I wanted to share something with you that Bill wrote, which has to do with his adventure through that first step and finding out what the basics of recovery are. And also, we do a lot of talking around here about how frustrating it must be for those of the medical profession, the psychiatric profession, the counselors, and even the priests, ministers, and rabbis trying to get us sober. And they seldom have any success at all. Okay, to Wives, chapter 8. With few exceptions, our book thus far has spoken of men. What we have said applies quite as much to women. Our activities in behalf of women who drink are on the increase. There's every evidence that women regain their health as readily as men if they try our suggestions. Well, surprise, surprise. I guess these guys are such chauvinists they were surprised to find that women were human beings too. I'm not sure they're right, but they probably are. For every man who drinks, others are involved. The wife who trembles in fear of the next debauch. Anybody here wonder what a debauch is? Debauchery. You don't often hear that word anymore, do we? That's getting stinking drunk. A next debauch. The mother and father who see their son wasting away. Among us are wives, relatives, and friends whose problem has been solved, as well as some who have not yet found a happy solution. We want the wives of Alcoholics Anonymous to address the wives of men who drink too much. What they say will apply to nearly everyone bound by ties of blood or affection to an alcoholic. As wives of Alcoholics Anonymous, we would like you to feel that we understand as perhaps you can. We want to analyze the mistakes we've made. We want to leave you with the feeling that no situation is too difficult and no unhappiness too great to be overcome. Wow, that's a pretty strong statement, isn't it? You know, one of the main themes of this chapter is as we read it, you need to be aware of what's going on here. Bill's really leading up to this, that you, wife, can have a happy, productive life in spite of the fact that you're married to a damn drunk who is not recovering, and he's always been causing all kinds of difficulty, and you don't need to have to be that way. You can have a reasonably happy life on your own. But when you think about that, think about what's going here. This dependency which the wives had developed on their alcoholic husband was that one thing which was causing them most of their pain. And what Bill is advocating here, what this chapter advocates, is a breaking away from that dependency. And as you will see, the way that that's done primarily is for the wives to work the steps. You say, oh, well, wait a minute. They're supposedly not alcoholics. How can they work the steps? They're not alcoholics. Well, that's a very common misunderstanding. Anybody, any human being can work the steps. They're for everybody. They're not just for alcoholics and the occasional drug addict who wanders in here. They're for everybody. Why? Well, it's simple. The 12 steps are great spiritual principles applicable to every human being, restated as steps of action, which means quite simply that if we learn to take that action, we will incorporate those spiritual principles into our very being. They become the way we live our lives. And every human being gains immeasurably from that. I've taken quite a few people through the steps who are not alcoholics. And those who had the courage and the motivation to actually face themselves, as we have to do, have done quite well. It's changed their lives just as it changes our lives. So they got the same problems we have. They just don't drink over them. And so as we read this chapter, we're going to see an appeal to the wives to break loose from this terrible dependency that they've developed on their husbands, and the expectations which they have developed, which are constantly being thwarted and frustrated, and to begin to live their lives standing on their own two feet. In effect, it's saying, leave the rascal alone. Let him do whatever the hell he's going to do. You don't have to be sick because he's sick. It's a pretty interesting theory, isn't it? There's nothing in here that is to instruct the wife what she's to do to get this guy sober or to change him, because it's clear that she can't change him. She hasn't got any power to do that any more than he has to do it for himself. So the subject here is her. How do you and the kids survive this illness in your house with a certain amount of grace and happiness? And this chapter is designed to show her exactly how to do that. So we keep that in mind too as we read it. And so he says here, we want to leave you with the feeling that no situation is too difficult and no unhappiness too great to be overcome. We have traveled a rocky road, there is no mistake about that. We've had long rendezvous with hurt, pride, frustration, self-pity, misunderstanding, and fear. These are not pleasant companions. He does not mean there that it's only on the part of the husband who is exhibiting these things, but that they affected the wife as well. She has been caught up in pride, frustration, self-pity, misunderstanding, and fear. We have been driven to maudlin sympathy, to bitter resentment. Some of us have veered from extreme to extreme, ever hoping that one day our loved ones would be themselves once more. Our loyalty and the desire that our husbands hold up their heads and be like other men have begotten all sorts of predicaments. We've been unselfish and self-sacrificing. Oh my. We have told innumerable lies to protect our pride and our husband's reputations. Notice that Bill puts their pride first before the reputation of their husband, and that's true. And he's going right to the heart of motivations here. I'm going to tell the lie because I don't want anybody to know what I'm married to, or how stupid of me to stay with him, or how could I have made such a terrible mistake in the first place. We have prayed, we have begged, we have been patient. We have struck out viciously. We've run away. We've been hysterical. We've been terror-stricken. We've sought sympathy, and we've had retaliatory love affairs with other men. There's some guys, you know, when they read this, they say, well, I wonder where these wives are. You know? Yeah, this must be one of those fringe benefits of being in the program. I suppose we could start a new fellowship, Retaliators Anonymous. Our homes have been battlegrounds many an evening. In the morning we have kissed and made up. Our friends have counseled chucking the men, and we've done so with finality, only to be back in a little while, hoping, always hoping. Our men have sworn great solemn oaths that they were through drinking forever. We believed them when no one else could or would. Then in days, weeks, or months, a fresh outburst. Why did you go back to that song? But I love him. We seldom had friends at our homes, never knowing how or when the men of the house would appear. We could make few social engagements. We came to live almost alone. When we were invited out, our husbands sneaked so many drinks that they spoiled the occasion. If on the other hand, they took nothing, their self-pity made them killjoys. See what's happening here? In talking to the wives, this chapter is describing their husbands. And why is that so important for us to keep, I keep harping on it, because this is flat first step material. This is the kind of thing that the newcomer coming in needs to read. Some of you wonder, why does Jim always say you gotta read the whole book when you come in new? Well, looky here, this is stuff you don't find anywhere else in this book. It's a description of us. This is the kind of stuff that we begin to identify ourselves with. This is what helps us break down the walls of denial. There was never financial security. Positions were always in jeopardy or gone. Now, that's a bit of an overstatement, isn't it? And I think when Bill wrote that, he probably forgot what he wrote about Fred back in chapter 3. Remember old Fred? Old Fred, he didn't have any problems with money. He was a very successful professional, making lots of money, had a beautiful home, a couple of cars in the garage, nice kids. His wife wasn't that pissed off at him either, because he was apparently a periodic, wasn't drunk all the time. But Fred nevertheless was an alcoholic, in spite of the fact that he had not lost anything. When the time came for him to drink and he met one of those strange metal blank spots, he called them, he'd be off and running for several days. And so the fact that financial security is always a victim of alcoholism is not true, but most of the time it is true. And most of the people who read that are going to say, yeah, that's me. I haven't been able to hold a job down for the last 5 years. There was never financial security. Positions were always in jeopardy or gone. The armored car could not have brought the pay envelopes home. The checking account melted like snow in June. Sometimes there were other women. How heartbreaking was this discovery? How cruel to be told they understood our men as we did not. The bill collectors, the sheriffs, the angry taxi drivers, the policemen, the bums, the pals, and even the ladies they sometimes brought home. Really? Yeah. I guess, you know, in the 30s, this institution of marriage was so solidly set in stone that the guys could get away with it. I mean, they were going to have to suffer for it, you know, but at least it wasn't going to break up their home. Because breaking up a home just wasn't done back then. You know, there were kids, there was a family, there was all the rest of the family, and somehow or another the wives would just muddle through with it, put up with it. Our husbands, let's see, ladies they sometimes brought home, our husbands thought we were so inhospitable. Joy killer, nag, wet blanket, that's what they said. Next day they would be themselves again, and we would forgive and try to forget. So I wonder what he did with that lady he brought home. We've tried to hold the love of our children for their father. We've told small tots that father was sick, which was much nearer the truth than we realized. They struck the children, kicked out door panels, smashed treasured crockery, and ripped the keys out of pianos. Wow. How many people here, be honest now, who among you has ever ripped the keys out of a piano? How many of you ever had a piano to rip the keys out? If you did, you ripped the keys out, David? Oh, wow. Can you get the mental image of that? This drunk kind of stumbling around, where's that piano? I want to rip the keys out of that sucker. Rip the keys out of pianos. In the midst of such pandemonium, they may have rushed out threatening to live with the other woman forever. In desperation, we've even got tight ourselves. The drunk to end all drunks. The unexpected result was that our husband seemed to like it. Yeah, maybe she's going to loosen up here a little bit. Hey, Maggie, why don't you just do that every night, man? I really like this stuff. Come on and join me. I've always wanted to have a wife I could drink with. They liked it. Besides, at this point, we got a divorce. Perhaps at this point, we got a divorce and took the children home to father and mother. Well, now, that's what had to happen back then. You see, these gals, they weren't career women. They had, their training was that as soon as you are eligible, you find some guy who'll have you, get married. Then you make the best of it. And if you have to leave them, you go home to mom and dad. And that's got to be a big reason why a lot of them would stick around through what, no matter what was happening. You sure as hell didn't want to go home to mom and dad. That was a bad place too. Then we were severely criticized by our husband's parents for desertion. You see, remember you got married, remember what you said in front of the altar, for better or worse, in sickness and in health, till death do us part. I don't guess you guys do that anymore, do you? No. My one and only marriage, I remember we said that. I stuck around through 12 years of total insanity. In fact, I stayed until they came and dragged her away. Literally. Thinking back on it, if it had been a little bit later, there would have been no particular incentive to do that. But I believed those vows. I believed that they meant something. And I guess a lot of people still do today. I do. We were severely criticized by our husband's parents for desertion. Usually we did not leave. We stayed on and on. We finally sought employment ourselves as destitution faced us and our families. You remember Lois, they didn't have any kids, but Lois was working in a department store long before Bill got sober. And she kept on doing that because he didn't turn out to be much of a provider. He was too busy with AA, running around being an AA guru and big shot. And so she kept on working. I don't know when she quit, but it was many years after Bill got sober. And it was pretty much on her income that they subsisted all those years. We began to ask medical advice as the sprees got closer together. The alarming physical and mental symptoms, the deepening pall of remorse, depression, and inferiority that settled down on our loved ones. Now there's a description of us again. Physical and mental symptoms, deepening pall of remorse, depression, and inferiority. These things terrified and distracted us. As animals on a treadmill, we had patiently and wearily climbed, falling back in exhaustion after each futile effort to reach solid ground. Most of us have entered the final stage with its commitment to health resorts, sanitariums, hospitals, and jails. Sometimes there were screaming delirium and insanity. Death was often near. So there's the alcoholic husband, and a perfect description of the alcoholic wife. Alcoholics in general. I work with a lot of alcoholics who will never get married. That's not the way they live their lives. It doesn't matter, because the same conditions apply regardless of what kind of relationships we have. And it's interesting, you know, guys, because when we do our fourth step, we're going to be looking in what is what we call the sex inventory. We're going to be looking at how we related. That's what relationship is. It's a condition within which we relate to each other. How we related to other people. And we find that our relationships, in spite of what may have happened from the other side, our relationships have uniformly been unhealthy, unsuccessful. Regardless of whether it was a relationship in love or a relationship in business or family, because we didn't know how to have a relationship. And the more that they failed, the more we drank. And the more we drank, the more they failed. It was a terrible, self-fulfilling circle we were in. And when we do our inventory, we can see that the basic problem always was selfishness and self-centeredness. Living in self, decisions based on self, coupled with dishonesty. We put these two together, selfishness and dishonesty, and what would we find is just a whole series of failed relationships. These conditions, we naturally made mistakes. Some of them arose out of ignorance of alcoholism. Sometimes we sensed dimly that we were dealing with sick men. Had we fully understood the nature of alcoholic illness, we might have behaved differently. And now we begin to see what this chapter is all about, don't we? Because this chapter is now going to set out the task of instructing the wife what's wrong with her husband. What is this thing called alcoholism? And it's going to get very specific about this. The hope is that the wife who reads this book, and especially this chapter, will have such a strong knowledge of the disease that it will in fact change her life. And she will have the opportunity to begin to act and react to the alcoholic in her family with a new outlook, a new understanding of what was really going on there. How could men who love their wives and children be so unthinking, so callous, so cruel? There could be no love in such persons, we thought. And just as we were being convinced of their heartlessness, they would surprise us with fresh resolves and new attentions. For a while, they would be their old sweet selves, only to dash the new structure of affection to pieces once more. Asked why they commenced to drink again, they would reply with some silly excuse, or none. But you know, guys, the word, the silly excuse is something that applies to every excuse for us. Every excuse for us is a silly excuse. Now, the treatment center would have you think otherwise. They'd like you to think about all these triggers, as if somehow or another that trigger was inevitably would lead to a drink. That's not true. We drink because we are alcoholics and because we are powerless over alcohol. We drink because we are spiritually bankrupt. We drink because we have no higher power between us and booze. That's why we drink. And there is no such thing as a valid excuse for that. We love it when somebody says, well, here's why you drank. We cure this problem here, over here, we get rid of this trigger and you won't drink again. That's balderdash. It's a total nonsense. Doesn't work. Hell's bells, if that worked, wouldn't need any AA, would we? All we'd have to do is find out what made us drink and correct those problems using human solutions, and then we'd be fine. We wouldn't drink again. And that's, of course, the basic theory upon which human solutionists like to operate. That if we can just get enough knowledge about ourselves and, in quotes, why we drink, then we'll stop drinking. Never worked before, doesn't work now. Best chances it never will work. Because that's not the problem. We ask why they commence to drink again. They would reply with some silly excuse or none. It was so baffling, so heartbreaking. Could we have been so mistaken in the men we married? See, there's a lot of the pride mixed up here. There's an awful lot more going on here than simply a reaction to somebody's drinking. When drinking, they were strangers. Sometimes they were so inaccessible it seemed as though a great wall had been built around them. We know what that is. We've done that ourselves. And even if they did not love their families, how could they be so blind about themselves? What had become of their judgment, their common sense, their willpower? Why could they not see that drink meant ruin to them? Why was it when these dangers were pointed out that they agreed and then got drunk again immediately? This is us, this whole paragraph. How could we have been so blind about ourselves? What happened to our judgment, our common sense? What happened to our willpower? Why couldn't we see that drink meant ruin for us? Why was it when these dangers were pointed out that we agreed and then got drunk again immediately? See how perfectly apt this is for a new person? That's a description of powerlessness, isn't it? These are some of the questions which race to the mind of every woman who has an alcoholic husband. We hope this book has answered some of them. Perhaps your husband has been living in that strange world of alcoholism where everything is distorted and exaggerated. You can see that he really does love you with his better self. Of course, there is such a thing as incompatibility, but in nearly every instance, the alcoholic only seems to be unloving and inconsiderate. It is usually because he is warped and sickened that he says and does these appalling things. Today, most of our men are better husbands and fathers than ever before. So let's hear what Bill said about his own particular experience. This is from Language of the Heart. If you have your book with you, you could follow along. This is a wonderful book to have, by the way. It has all of Bill's writings from 1944 through 1969, which were published in the Grapevine. This is an article written in 1968. It's on page 285, is where we're going to start. Oh, I got that wrong. It's sorry about that, 283. And we had talked in the past, you remember, about Dr. Jung, the great psychiatrist, and that he had treated Roland H. and Roland Hazard, and Roland had spent a year with him and had been fully psychoanalyzed, and he'd put them through the whole ringer for a whole year. And Roland went over to Switzerland and stayed there during the time he was in treatment. And Roland came back from Switzerland and felt that he was probably cured, because he gained all the knowledge about himself. But he drank again, and he went back to Switzerland to talk to Dr. Jung. And Bill kind of picks up the story at that point. As Jung had told Roland that his case was hopeless, and that medicine and psychiatry could do nothing more for him, so Silkworth told Lois on a fateful day in the summer of 1934, "I'm afraid that Bill will have to be committed. There is nothing that I can do for him, or anybody else that I know." These were the words of great humility from a professional. Now, you know, when we think about it, you and I are afflicted with a disease which will kill us, and it is incurable, and it is always deadly. And if we drink at all, it will get us. And the problem there is that we can't stop drinking. What a dilemma. If I could only stop drinking, I wouldn't die. If I do start drinking, I will immediately trigger the obsession to drink and the compulsion to drink and the allergy to alcohol, which is the hallmark of the alcoholic, then I won't be able to stop. So what do I do? Well, the answer, of course, is in the big book. Bill says, "These were the words of great humility from a professional. They scared me into sobriety for 2 months, although I soon resumed my drinking. But the message that Evie had brought me from Dr. Jung and from the Oxford groups, and the sentence that Dr. Silkworth pronounced over me, continued to occupy my mind in every waking hour thereafter. I began to be very resentful." Here was Dr. Silkworth, who had defined alcoholism, the obsession that condemns you to drink against your will and true interests, even unto destruction, and the bodily sensitivity that guarantees madness and death if you drink at all. And here came Dr. Jung via Roland and Ebby, confirming that there was no way out known to the doctors. My God, science, the only God I had then, had declared me hopeless. But Ebby had also brought hope. Not much later, I was back in the hospital in Dr. Silkworth's care after what proved to be my very last drunk. Ebby came to visit me again. I asked him to repeat once more what he had said over my kitchen table in Brooklyn that first time when he told me how he had gotten sober. Now here's a wonderful praises of the program that Ebby gave to Bill. He said, "Well," he said, "you know, you get honest with yourself. You make a self-survey. You talk it out with the other guy. You quit living alone and begin to get straight with the world around by making restitution. You try the kind of giving that demands no reward, either in approval, prestige, or money. And you ask whatever higher power there is, even if it's just an experiment, to help you find the grace to be released from alcoholism." As Evie put it, it was quite simple, quite matter of fact, and said with a smile. But this was it. In other words, Bill saying, that's what you had to do. Science had failed and would always fail, still does today. So Evie finally took his leave. Now came the jaws of the dilemma really crushed. I hit an all-time block. I could only suppose that any particle of belief that there was a single thing I could do for myself alone was for the moment rubbed out. I found myself as a child, utterly alone in complete darkness. And I cried out as a child, expecting little, indeed, expecting nothing. I simply said, if there is a God, will he show himself? Then I was granted one of those instantaneous illuminations, the sort of thing that really defies description. I was seized with great joy and ecstasy beyond all possible expression. In the mind's eye, it seemed to me I stood on a high mountain. I was taken there. I had not climbed it. And then the great thought burst upon me, Bill, you are a free man. This is the God of the Scriptures. And then I was filled with a consciousness of a presence. A great peace fell over me. And I was with this I don't know how long. But then the dark side put in an appearance and said to me, perhaps, Bill, you are hallucinating. You'd better call in the doctor. So the doctor came, and I haltingly told me of the experience. Then came great words for Alcoholics Anonymous. The little man had listened, looking at me so benignly with those blue eyes of his, and at length he said to me, Bill, you are not crazy. I've read about this sort of thing in the books, but I've never seen it firsthand. I don't know what it is you have, Bill, but it must be some great psychic event, and you had better hang on to it. It is so much better than what you had only an hour ago. So I hung on, and then I knew there was a God, and I knew there was a grace. And through it all, I have continued to feel, if I may presume to say it, that I do know these things. And of course, as Bill has said in other writings, it never left him. He continued with that for the rest of his life. So it's important, I think, for us to always keep our eye on what's real for us. Not all this imaginary stuff that floats around, not all these human solutions and scientific solutions, because they're dead ends. You know what it is that's wrong there? It's that these human solutions do not take into account the simple fact that you and I are spiritually bankrupt. And that what's problem with us is a problem of the spirit. And it's a problem of powerlessness. And that we have a disease over which we have absolutely no power. And that therefore, in order for us to recover, it's absolutely essential that we get a higher power between us and our disease. And that's what the 12 steps do for us. If we're willing to use them and to stay with them for the rest of our lives. That's another fact which is quite basic to AA. This is a lifetime program. There is no graduation. There is not even a vacation. There's not even a long weekend. And those who went to dance tonight, God bless them. I hope they make it back on Monday. That was a joke. Thanks for all those laughs. I got a couple of laughers over here. I have them come in every Saturday just so we have laugh leaders in the room. Thank you very much for that. So you see, every time we pick up this book and read it, every time we talk about the steps and God and recovery, we have to remember what's going on here. Without this, we're doomed. Without this, we don't make it. And once we fully understand that, we can put aside all the foolishness that crowds in on us from all different points of the compass around these hallowed halls. You get back to basics and stay there. One of the things about the first step, which is so very interesting, is that in our big book, it's scattered all the way through the book. There isn't any one paragraph or one chapter or even one section of the book which can be labeled a first step material. A lot of people, a lot of sponsors these days take shortcuts, and one of the shortcuts is to get somebody new and tell them to read the doctor's opinion in the first two or three chapters, and they miss 90% of what the big book has to say about the first step. Well, let's think about first step for a minute, because it's quite appropriate here to the chapter of the wise. Believe it or not, this chapter has some of the greatest first step material in the whole book. And it has stuff in it that is not addressed anywhere else in the book. Because this is a putatively addressed to the wise, and yet it's really telling the wise about us. And in telling the wise about us, it's defining us and defining our disease. And defining not only our disease, but our reactions to that disease and how we act and what our state of mind is. Defines our insanity and our insane actions. Defines the whole psyche of the alcoholic in order that the wife better understand what she's trying to deal with. This chapter is the only place in the big book which clearly sets forth all of the elements of the progression of the disease of alcoholism. You know, you would think that somewhere back in chapter 3 or chapter 2 or somewhere, the big book would have given us a full description of the progression, because it mentions it, but just briefly. Here in this chapter, we've got 6 or 7 pages defining the progression of the disease. And this is done in order that the wife be able to see what's happening with her husband. It goes through all the stages of the disease and shows how it progresses from one stage to the next. This is also the chapter which addresses itself to something which is quite basic to our recovery. And that is that the people we have to deal with are all sick. And I don't mean most of them, I mean all of them. And I suppose there will be some rare exceptions, but for almost everybody who's out there, we're going to find that they have the same defects that we have. They just don't drink over it. They may do a lot of other stuff, but we're setting them aside and we're saying they're not alcoholics. If they're alcoholics, we have no problem defining what they're all about, because we know we've been there too. This is critical because, of course, when we are doing our fourth step, the big book tells us when we get through with our resentment list, that we realize that these people who harmed us were perhaps spiritually sick too. And that sounds like a gigantic excuse for them. It's the same kind of excuse we hear all the time from the treatment centers. Like, oh, she did the best she could, so you're not supposed to hate her. It's wrong for you to hate her because she did the best she could. But that does absolutely nothing to dispel the hatred or the resentment. It's still there. The idea being that somehow or another we can rationalize our way out of hatred and resentment and anger, and we can't. We don't have any power over that stuff. It's got us in its grips. It has us by the throat. So the spiritual solution to our resentments hinges upon our understanding that the people who harmed us have the same problems we have. They have the same illness we have. They probably don't drink over it. The same selfishness, same self-centeredness, same resentments and dishonesties. Absolutely the same fears, maybe even worse. And that therefore it is incumbent upon us to understand this so that we will, not because it means that we disregard what they did or talk ourselves out of it, but this will help us when it's necessary for us to ask God to make us willing to forgive the wrongs that they did. You see, this forgiveness is what sets us free. Praying for them and forgiving them. And so this chapter 8 is a chapter that gives us this information. And there's a lot more in here. And much of it is simply descriptive of you and me. Now then, this is an interesting chapter too, because it really contains the only lie in the big book. The big book is all truth. Dr. Silkworth said it in his little letter that's printed in the front of the book. And he's talking about the authors of this book. He said you can absolutely rely upon whatever they say about themselves. But here, Bill had asked his wife to write this chapter, and she said no. So Bill wrote it, and that rascal pretends now to be a wife. So what we really have is Bill Wilson in drag. And shame on him, he had to lie about it, because he felt that the dramatic impact of one wife talking to other wives would be lost if he were to fess up to the fact that he wrote it. And of course, there's another lesson in this, isn't there? Why was it that wives were set apart as a separate category? Well, the wives in the days when the big book was written, there may have been some boozers among that bunch, but they didn't identify themselves. And of course, wives, in the families, the wives were pretty much protected, even if they were nipping at the cooking sherry from the time that Guiding Light was over until Stella Dallas came on. But they came to the meetings. You see, the wives in those days were integral parts of the recovery of their husbands. And likewise, of what was being helped, well, how they were being able to help their children. Because there was none of this foolishness about the wives couldn't be in the meetings because the meeting was closed, in quotes. After all, they might go down to their sewing circle and rat out everybody that they saw at that meeting last night. Guess who I saw down at the meeting? There's a drunk. Yeah, Dr. Bob was down there. This guy Bill Wilson was down there. We didn't pay attention to that. The wives were an integral part. In fact, it was known at that time, which we've flat forgotten now, and most of us have, this is a family disease. How many times have I worked with people, thousands of times with people, who identified themselves as part of a very sick family? It's a family disease. And sometimes the major progenitor of the disease of the family is the drunk that we have in front of us that we're trying to help. And sometimes that drunk is just a product of a family that is sick all the way through. Being a family disease, there are a lot of factors involved there. For example, it is estimated, and I don't know where this comes from, but it sounds like it might be right, that every alcoholic seriously affects the lives of at least 7 other people. And that could be true. Certainly, there's a wide circle of people whom we seriously affect during our drinking days. And so it's significant that it was felt in 1939 that it was necessary to set the wives off as a separate category. That category, obviously, as we read this chapter, was the category of a non-drinker, a non-alcoholic, but a person who is the victim, nevertheless, of the disease of alcoholism, because that's what they saw was happening. There was no standing apart from the disease. It infected the whole family. There are a lot of reasons for that, aside from the actions of the drunk in the family. Remember that one of the primary attributes or significant symptoms of alcoholism is overwhelming fear. And fear, by its very nature, is extremely contagious. And it's very toxic. And a family which is living with a practicing alcoholic is a family which is being bathed in fear. And they might just as well say I could avoid getting the Asian flu if I simply expose myself to it 15, 16 hours a day, every day. And that's probably not going to happen either. And that fear is something which we learn as alcoholics in recovery, we learn to deal with that fear. But the people around us do not. And sometimes this means that we're going to have to spend a good part of our time being aware of the fears that are engendered by our contact constantly with fearful people and deal with that on a daily basis. And so with all those things in mind, let's take a look at the chapter to wives on page 104. Let's go down to the bottom of the page first of all. See the footnote down there? Do we have a footnote in the third edition, or is it only in the fourth? Okay, written in 1939 when there were few women in AA. This chapter assumes that the alcoholic in the home is likely to be the husband. But many of the suggestions here given here may be adapted to help the person who lives with a woman alcoholic, whether she is still drinking or is recovering in AA. A further source of help is noted on page 121. Now, that footnote is true because that footnote says few women in AA, and the truth is there was one woman in AA. Marty Mann. Marty had come in about the same time that Bill wrote the first draft, the manuscript of the big book. And he had sent her a copy of that multi-lit first draft. He charged her $3.50 for it. But he told her that if she bought that draft, that when the hardcover book came out, she would be entitled to receive a copy free. So Marty was the first woman in AA, and she learned her AA from Bill's manuscript, and of course, from the people in the New York group, the men, M-E-N, the males, masculine gender, who worked with her and sponsored her. Now, of course, as you all know today, she could never have gotten sober, could she? They would have had to tell her, sorry, Marty, there's nothing we can do to help you, we're men. And the last time we looked, you're a woman. And of course, this was repeated over and over again as each new group came online. There'd be the first woman in the group. You gotta ask yourself, those poor dears, they were all doomed to an alcoholic death because nobody could sponsor them, nobody could help them. All the guys had to stay away from them because after all, men can't have anything to do with helping women get sober. At least that's what it says in that scurrilous, rotten, stinking little book called Living Sober. Which, as you might surmise from my comment, I don't like at all. There's so much in the way of absolute balderdash. Balderdash. And we take this stuff and eat it up. It's like spoon it into our yaps. We say, oh, yeah, that tastes good. That must be all right. We don't think it through. We don't think how utterly stupid it is to say that the person carrying the message must be of the same gender. Why? Why? Our rent is paid for this month?
June was paid, June 1st, yes. But in 2 weeks it'll be July 1st and I have to buy some books, so I don't think it's just going to anybody. So I only got $174 and I got to buy supplies.
All right. Supplies. I heard that. Okay, Dominic or GSR there, what do you have for us?
I announced it last meeting that they bridged the gap for
you. Okay.
And they have now, I don't know, the way the money's been going out, they have, which I found out by being over there, they have inter-sponsored groups that we, I don't know if you can ever bother with it. They have a District 9 group meeting up there. Then there's the interview, what you can say. And then they have the Area 15, which is the South Florida. And then there's the General Service in New York. Those are four fledgling ceremony. Now, I don't know about the District 9. That's the one that handles most of the people that go to these functions that we have. They're really kind of tight on money. Now, I don't think it should change it really until I find out more about it. Because the feeling I got, it seemed like some of the people that were up there, you know, the DSMs and DSAs and all of that, a couple of them are thinking of trying to go on a free boat and stay up there and making that group pay for it at District 9. And if that's the case, then I'd rather, if you want to send it that way, you can.
We've just been sent it to General Service in New York.
Right. I mean, that's the only one. That's why when that literature comes out, you don't see any recognition of the stairway.
Right.
It's because that's the District 9.
Right.
And that's the one that does, now they have that big convention down in Naples, which is coming up in July.
Another 5 minutes.
Which they're going to be discussing that the Bridge the Gap group. I met two of the people that actually started a year ago, a Wally Love and a Dick Nelson. And they started a year ago. Now they got another fine print. They're going to be the speakers at the Naples group when they had that meeting in Naples. But I'm going to meet this Dick Nelson. I'm going to meet him in the next week or so. I'm trying to get a phone up before I see what it's going to be all about. He says he has some literature already printed up that he's going to present that I'm not there, so I want to get my hands on it. And if it comes out to what it's going to be, I will mimeograph copies, finalizing the names and addresses, because everybody, I don't know, you are here, Steve. The way this works is that anybody that's in an institution or a treatment, when they're in an institution, they sign for this program. And when they sign for a program, their name then, before they release it, sent to Washington, AA. AA, in turn, from there, sends it to District 9. When we compile names, if anybody in our group wants to get involved in it, it's going to be all of District 9, which is 50 areas, or 20 areas. From that, then geographically, from District 9, they will send out the name to the person that wants to get involved in this. and it's only a 5-day process. It's a matter of meeting the person the day he gets out at night, take him to his first room or female to their first meeting, stay with them that time because they feel being where so oriented to going to meetings instead of them working in the hall, going to somebody that knows and get them familiarized with the program. Once you, the way you say about that is why I'm feeling like half grasp of this. After they're familiarized, they can pick up a temporary response or something like that, your obligation is done. Unless the person really wants to say, you want to stay with the person or not, you don't take that responsibility. But after that's done, then it goes back to mind again that the individual is available again if someone else should be released and wants to get back involved. It's the repetition. It's almost like doing a 12-step program over the 5-day limitation just to get them used to coming to meetings. That's all it's for. So I'll know more between now and late July.
All right. Dominic, so you and Marilyn are happy where the money's going to?
Well, like I said, keep doing it the way you're doing it. I'll work out clearly.
Okay.
If I feel any one of these are going to be beneficial to something that's local.
All right.
And if you feel you've got to support something local as a group, then you turn around and put the vote and say, yeah, I want to send something to Cert 9. I want to help that organization out. You know, that would be something that should be added to the group consciousness.
Well, it won't make any difference this month because we're not sending money in.
All right, but I just want to get that straight down.
Yeah.
All right, very good.
Sponsorship workshop. clean up everything, clean up too, as I can see. Yeah, all right, so I guess our cleanup will just be on a voluntary weekly basis.
Oh, yeah.
Can we ask the city commission if there are any volunteers to help? Can you talk to them?
Well, the better to see people, I mean, empty the ashtrays and pick up the...
People make way.
I'd say...
Yeah, we all have to go clean it.
It's not like all that stuff has to be put away and stuff.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
So we ask for some volunteers, maybe to help clean our department, how close to... Yeah, they all have that, but, you know, last week, we all just did it every day, you know, but it was much bigger group this week, it was not as full. It's like very helpful, you know, to go in. Have that announced at the end of the week?
All there is every meeting or for the rest of our lives.
Yes, say that again?
As a volunteer for the rest of our lives, you know. I'm only kidding. Okay, last day, that'd be there for me.
But we have to make some changes in the law, not the table. Because, you know, I mean, people just think you're going to...
Right, clean up their own tables.
Right, so we're asking for a little extended help to get the coffee pot.
Clean the coffee pot and put everything away at the meeting, right?
Could somebody assist, you know? They go, you know, the same. Anyone else?
Yeah, I'll start that. Okay, I think that's about it. The only thing I got to say is South County Rehab closed out the detox about a year ago. And I talked to the nurses, and they're getting more detox patients in there. Nobody's bringing in meetings to come. And so I'm going to go check into it. So in about a month, I might be looking for volunteers to bring in meetings to South County. I'm just doing this on my own. The institutions committee, I'm not even going to go to the council. I've got a lot of work in South County. That's it. Close meeting.
Okay, guys, we're going to start our Language of the Heart meeting in just a couple minutes.